Before I get a timekeeper, I do want to say, I think you are doing great. It is, I would much rather be up here doing this presentation and sitting where you're sitting to try to sit in these chairs are not the best in the world. Which, I should have mentioned this earlier, okay? Anytime you want to stand up and move around, if you just want to get up and pace in the back, it won't bother me at all. I know some people just get really cramped and you may get a cramp in your leg or your back, so may bother you. That doesn't bother me at all. So feel free, just don't stand up where you are. People behind you can't see, just get up and go over there and you're welcome to do that. Okay, our next break will be at lunch at 12 noon. Who in this room will let me know when it's 12 noon? You're on, okay. All my timekeepers have done really great. Questions? Any comments? Any thoughts? Anybody? Normally, yes! Yay! She has a thought or a comment. Good, go for it.
We were discussing, like, where would we come up with the budget for things such as art or animals or...
Right. Yeah. If anything takes money and the money is not available for that thing, move on. Don't focus on it. There are two columns in life. There's a column in life of things we can control and a column in life of things we cannot control. The list of things that I am giving you is an infinite list of opportunities. And it may be that for some reason a dog cannot work out in that house that they live in, but next door there is a family that has a dog. Can we connect with them and say, can we walk your dog? Can we spend time with your dog? Can your dog come over? Take what you can get closest to what you want. Start low, go slow. Figure out what you need to do. There are two columns in life. Again, I'm going to make a point. A column of life of things we can control and a column of life of things we cannot control. There are some people who spend their whole life on the non-controllable column. Guess what we call those people? Victims. Victims are people who focus on those things they cannot control. And by the way, the victim has a mantra. Ready for the victim's mantra? She to him or him to her. Hey, this is important because in order to be successful, in order to make this stuff work, you cannot be a victim, okay? So that's why I loved your question, right? That's great. Is that the victim's mantra, she to him or him to her. Ready? You make me miserable. You make me miserable. Here's my feelings. You're in charge. I've been waiting 7 years. Make me happy. Make me happy. Well, I have a response for the victim. You got a long wait. But there are people who honestly think that way. And it has, there's a lot of reasons that pathology, because that's not a healthy thought, right? We are responsible for our own feelings. We are responsible for our future. It's the choices that we make and how we make them. There are things that happen in the non-controllable column that impact our life. God forbid people have cancer. And if they may have made the best decision, things happen. But generally, what we want to do is you want to focus on the controllable column. Now, here's another point. I will give you hundreds of examples of stuff. And just think about some of the stuff that just comes out of my mouth. Extended brake handles, lower a closet bar, take the doors out from under the kitchen sink. People should be, adults should be sleeping in at least a double bed, okay? Well, that list goes on and on and on and on. Scopolamine patches, I don't care, just don't worry about it. Listen to this point. My examples are irrelevant. If you walk out of this room and you tell somebody, Tom said people are supposed to be sleeping in a double bed. You didn't understand why we're here. Those people who do that, what they're trying to do is get hung up over the example. I'm interested in the principle. The principle is treating people with dignity and respect, supporting people in active participation in their lives. It's the people who are trying to come up with a reason why we're not going to do these things that will focus on the example. Don't worry about the examples. They're irrelevant. And the only reason I use examples, I have no way of communicating a principle unless I give you an example. There's no other way to do it. So even if you say, well, what happens if people don't have an animal? I don't care whether they have a dog or not. I really don't. Because there's a million other things that you can do to enhance the quality of their life. We need to figure it out. That's the bottom line. This is not about thinking outside the box, friends. This is about blowing up the damn box. No, this is a different way of thinking. You know, you can't get stuck in the old way of doing things. It's empowering. Any other questions before I give you a poem? Yes, ma'am. All right, great. Which, by the way, you will know that when you ask me a question, it opens up a whole realm of discussion that you never would have heard had you not asked the question. Yes, ma'am.
Yes. Ask outside sources.
Correct.
When we ask for, like, we go to a particular company that wants to help people with disabilities,
yes,
legal advice or something, we just ask them some questions that they either weren't able to assist,
yes,
or have, like, they can't service. Where do you go from there?
Right. Her question is that our job is not necessarily to have the answers, it's to have the questions, and let's say in one particular case somebody needs some legal advice. And you go to some kind of advocacy group or an organization that's supposed to give legal advice, but they're not really giving very good advice, or none at all, for whatever reason. He's not eligible for advice or whatever. Is that where do you go from there? I can't answer that question. And there's a term, right? It's called, if you want to make note, a priori. A priori. It's a Latin term. It means before the fact. You know, if I knew the situation, I might be able to answer it because that's what I really do for a living. Now, this is something that I'm going to share with you that they may not have told you, which is fine. But here's the deal. My contract with your four agencies, are you ready? Includes, and Bob is in the room, so he will validate it, 1 year of consultation with any of you and anybody at your agency at no additional charge. Telephone or email consultation on anything that you want. Is that correct, Bob?
That is correct.
That's correct. And that is part of the agreement. Now, when you contact me, you need to go through your organization. You just don't call me. You need permission from your supervisor. No, anybody is right. I'm available to you. So if you have folks, I do a lot of what are called life studies, people who have extreme interfering conduct, they'll run out of the house, or they'll engage in aggression. That's what I deal with in my, you know, what I do. So if you have folks who you don't know where to turn and what to do, then I am available to you. This session today is not intended to be a session where I just come in, dump a bunch of stuff on you, and say, bye, I'll see you. I'm letting you know, I'm yours for a year. And I return every email, I return every phone call, challenging before the sun goes down. And I may, you may say, well, Tom, I just sent you a 14-page behavior support plan. Can you look at it? You will have a response before the sun. No, you will have a response. My response will be, I did get it. I will not be back in the office until this weekend. I will look at it then. No. Like, I'm very serious. I may not be able to do what you want me to do when you want me to do it, but doggone it, I value every one of you enough that you are going to hear from me before the sun goes down. Right, Bob? I mean, because I've interacted with him a lot. And because I want to be a model for you, that's what I expect of you. When you contact me, always give me the name of the agency that you're with and reference this session that you were at on this day, and give me a telephone number to call you. I always have to have a telephone number. Is that those kind of discussions don't work out on a text or an email. It's not that kind of thing usually. So if you have folks that are still being infantilized, treated as children, because you have age-inappropriate items that they're interacting with, and you don't know what alternative and options to give them, you call me. I got it, okay? And if you go to my website, you can even look at, read some of the articles on achieving the right of adult status and so forth. Yes?
I have one question.
Yeah, sure. Yes. Yeah, and it is a balance. We must, here's the point. When providing supports, you're participating as an equal. Okay, you all understand that? You are an equal. And now that requires a strong sense of self. The person who you support can't be in the subordinate position. You are not above them. And unfortunately, many organizations have, all four of your organizations have an organizational culture. That's not an opinion, it's a fact, okay? A culture. Sometimes the culture of an organization, when staff come in, they're led to believe that these are their clients. They even will use language like that. You know, these, as if I own them and I'm above them. No, You must participate as an equal. And if you're not comfortable with who you are as a person, you won't be able to do that. And so you will see people who come out of abusive relationships. It could be a woman who's in a very serious abusive relationship. It could be a man too. Abusive relationship with a significant other. And she feels like she has no control over her life. People can't live a life where they don't feel like they have control. They will tend to come into these agencies and take control of other people's lives. And you can see that. That's why I train supervisors and managers to help that staff, because they can't give up that control over that person. Really, really important. This is all psychological stuff, folks. You know, it's not just bullet, 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 bullet. Because it's all about us and how we see ourselves and who we are. Our sense of self. That's what it's about. Any other questions? Good question. Yes, ma'am. Allison.
What are your thoughts on age appropriate?
Yeah, and that's it. She asked me, what are my thoughts on age appropriateness? That's like pulling, that's a full day session. You go to my website. I like to do it in 2 days. It's called Achieving the Right of Adult Status. Yeah. My website, I put my website up here. I'll put it back up here again. And there are articles on my website, no charge. You can read them about that answer. If I answer the question at all, it is the most provocative issue in our field. People feel so strongly that these are children in adult bodies. They truly do. That if I gave you my answer, 10 more hands and 15, I'll be answering questions. So what I'm going to do is not answer the question. Just ask that if you want an answer, go to my website and read some of the articles on the website. If you're really interested, get a copy of my book. If you're really interested, have your agency order one of my DVDs, okay? Because if I started here, I will tell you, that's one of the reasons, by the way, that people are not involved in their life. Do you understand that? That's part of the infantilization process. Children are not expected to cook their meals. Children are not expected to clean their home. And so when we see adults as if they are children, we will use their disability as the explanation why they are not involved in their life. So denying people an opportunity to fully participate in their life is in part influenced because they are seen as children in adult lives. That's part of it. And agencies that have moved past that, where they truly see them as adults, they just accept and understand that they have to be involved in their own life. That's what adults do. And it's not just the involvement in home chores. You missed the point. It's that when one of their housemates pass away, are they given an opportunity to be a pallbearer? You understand, right? That being a pallbearer, I mean, commonly now you don't, it has nothing to do with whether you use a wheelchair and you can pick up a casket. It is a symbolic thing. And for decades in this country, there was a very large group of people, numbering in the millions, who were never allowed to be pallbearers. You know who those people were? Women, that's exactly right. Now women are commonly. There's another group of people who still are not pallbearers, and those are children. And when we see adults as if they are children, we will tend to treat them that way. Don't be leaving here and say, Tom said they're supposed to be pallbearers. No, but this is exactly, and if I don't say that, that's what will happen. People will go all ways, and Tom says they're supposed to give a eulogy. I mean, most of the people we support will never be given an opportunity to do a eulogy. Is that, this is just an aside. We had several homes in Hillsboro, Ohio. It's on the Ohio River, the southwestern part of Ohio. These were 8-person homes. And I did a lot of, these are homes our agency operated. So I knew the folks in the home. And most of the people who came into these homes came from a horrible, horrible place. A horrible state institution called Orient State School and Hospital. Somebody was from Ohio here. You ever heard of, there was somebody told me they were from Ohio when they came in. Yeah, you ever heard of Orient? Yeah. Horrible. It was closed under court order. Horrible. And two men had been living in Orient, two of the guys had moved into this home, from the time they were probably a year